Receive it because it's abundant life. It's life full of goodness and gladness. It's a heavenly life. No more sadness, no more sorrow. Hallelujah. Well, it's true. It's true. Look here. You can live in hell if you want to, but Papa's opened up the door for you to live in heaven. And he's not telling anybody that they got to stand outside till they get good enough. He's inviting everybody, come on in. Somebody said, well, you don't know the problems I'm going through. Look, let me just tell you right now. The Lord would like to give you a bigger set of problems. He said, well, what do you mean? Well, he wants you to graduate out of your problems through thanksgiving and celebration, step into a greater anointing, and then have to deal with 10 times more than what you've been going through, but you're equipped. Amen. Huh? Because if there's anything that has to take place in the United States of America, is people's going to have to understand the culture of the kingdom of God, the culture of heaven, the culture of the things of the Holy Spirit. People want to reduce it to religion and programs and ideas and rituals. Man, if you want to be silent, you can sit in your living room at home, be silent. We come in this place to shout.
Yeah. Hallelujah. Almighty God.
And of course, we're not shouting at one another. We lift up our voice and shouting to the Lord. Someone said, is it really necessary? Absolutely. The Lord didn't say walk around Jericho's walls and meditate. Hallelujah. He didn't say send out Judah first and let them just stand there and hum. He's commanded us to lift up our voice. And I tell you, I love being in a place where everybody knows how to shout on Sunday morning, knows how to rejoice in the living God on Sunday morning. Well, praise the name of Jesus. My dear friend Paul's here. You can be seated. Come up. Come up, Dr. Bald. Come on up. Just stay up here for just a minute. We don't know what we're going to do. We never know what we're going to do. Bald, come. Come. JMSA, come.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. 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 It's always a blessing when someone can go get their PhD at Oxford and still pray in the Holy Ghost.
Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah.
For those of you who don't know who Dr. Ball is, he's, and I'm just going to use his first name so we don't confuse you. Thank you, Lord, for your presence. Hallelujah. For those of you who don't know who he is, he's president of the Nepal Theological School. It's Assemblies of God Bible School. And they're raising up the pastors and leaders that are shaking the nation of Nepal.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. And so I wanted him to get right at it here this morning. And so if you want to worship and praise the Lord some more, which you should, then just come back tonight. We'll get after it again. But what if you extend it? Somebody said, it's just too hot. Can you turn the air conditioning on? Look, I'm telling you right now, you step over in this realm of praise and you won't even notice how hot it is. You'd be in heaven more than you are right now. We so want to encourage every one of you. Listen, God has provided a means by which we may live in a heavenly realm. I mean, it is heavenly And just as soon as you begin to participate in a heavenly realm and your emotions and your affections and your demeanor, and you don't want to leave that realm of joy unspeakable and full of glory, this beautiful realm of peace that passes understanding, this beautiful realm of the love of God which goes beyond knowledge, what will happen is then you'll be going to, you, living in that realm, you'll begin to minister out of that realm. Hallelujah. First of all, if it was just living in the realm and that's all we got to do, come on, man, that's just absolutely wonderful to live in heaven every day. Somebody said, well, you don't have any problems? Look, I got problems. It's just that I have the whole armor of God to deal with them, so I hardly even notice. You know what I'm saying? I mean, there's problems coming out against me. So I'm just in the midst of the fire of God. I'm living baptized in the very glory and presence of the Almighty, which dwells in the holies of holies. And I, you know, I've got to pay special attention should I, you know, have to even begin to deal with that. And Father wants that for you. That's why we're here. We're here just to encourage you to come live over in this realm. Don't be lost and caught up in the cares of this life and deceitfulness of riches. Look, come on. You don't have to go, you know, off into the wilderness somewhere and learn how to walk with God. God wants to teach you how to walk with Him in a secret place right where you're at right now. And in the mighty name of Jesus, I tell you, you've been empowered to do it. Hallelujah. And so just, So I said, well, how do I do that? Well, start with just practicing having a smile. Hallelujah. And then what's going to happen is you're going to discover that there's actually a living relationship with the Holy Ghost. Okay? And that you can say, Lord, Holy Spirit, fill me with your joy, and He will answer you, and you'll immediately be filled with a joy that is not earthly. Now, this is where it gets real, man. This is where the proof begins to be made manifest, okay? You can be in a great turmoil and ask the Holy Ghost for peace, and immediately you're filled with peace of God because there is a dialogue going on. There is a reciprocation between us and the living God, who's come to guide us and to lead us and to instruct us. And hallelujah. So I want you to forget about your struggle for just a minute, and I want you to lift one hand, two hands, whatever you want, towards heaven. And what's going to happen to you right now in the name of Jesus, I want you to receive right out of the realms of the Holy Ghost. I want you to receive a joy right out of the realms of the Spirit of the living God. I want you to receive a realm called heaven right now. It's a place called where Jesus is. It's where everywhere Jesus is, heaven's there. Jesus, right now, everything contrary to your way or that would block access to you, we bind it and remove it out of the way now in Jesus' name. And Father, I thank you that from this day forward, everybody in this place is going to know how to walk in this wonderful realm of living and dwelling and in the Holy Ghost, receiving those things that you've provided for us, Lord. Right now in Jesus' name. Right now in Jesus' name. Receive, 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 receive every good thing from heaven. Hallelujah. Receive, 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 receive every good thing from heaven. Receive, 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 receive every good thing from heaven. Receive right now in Jesus' name whatever you have need of. Receive right now in Jesus' name whatever you have need of. Receive, receive, receive right now. Receive, receive, receive right now. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, it is so sweet. It is so sweet to trust in Jesus. Just to take Him at His word. Just to rest upon His promise. Just to know the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust you, how I you am. Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, just for grace to trust.
Hallelujah, Spirit of the Lord, Spirit of the Lord.
Hallelujah, Riba Shadala, Rabaha Karaba Sandalai, Eria Bala, Ribu Rabba Shadala, Rada Yala Rakaraba Kandalai. Spirit of the Lord, Spirit of the Lord, Spirit of the Lord. Iraba Shadala Radala Rabba Shandala Rabba Kara Iraba Sayara Dara 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 Shadalai. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Spirit of God.
Speak now. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you. Praise God. It's my great privilege to be in this church today, and I thank Pastor Mark and his wife and children I have met in Nepal and minister together, and it's a great joy for me to come here and be with you this morning, and it's my great privilege. I have been in United States for a few days, and I wanted to come here, and Pastor Mark has been very kind, gracious to invite me here and talk to you today, share God's word with you. We have ministered together in Nepal, and especially I have translated him in some of the meetings, and he is one of the wonderful God servant in Nepal, and people love his preaching, and there has been a manifestation of the power of God, and the Spirit of God has been working in our country, and we thank Pastor Mark for his ministry in our nation. So I don't know how many minutes I speak. Oh. I'm basically a teacher. I teach in Bible college since 1981. Sometimes I can teach 4 hours non-stop. But I don't do all the time in all the places, because I want to also ask people how much time they give. So I have learned to operate many times in different ways. So before I share with you, I'd like to briefly, you might have already seen that video that Pastor Mark and myself, that we had a ministry together in a stadium in Nepal. And Anne, you were there that time. Stadium in Nepal, which seats about 25,000 people. And you can see in that, and you might have seen already in that video, I don't know whether that has been projected here, that I'll show you, and also a brief introduction of our college. It's a 4 minutes, it's not a video, it's a kind of photograph put together. So these two things I'll show you, then I'll speak from God's word, then we'll have time of prayer together. So it's ready, the video, or still you have to work on this? The first one is the crusade we had, if you can show that. Hallelujah.
I tell you, this might be our last meeting for now. But it is going to be a glorious
one.
God the Father is going to magnify the name of His Son Jesus. There are many people here today that are sick and they are going to be healed. There are many people here today that have been tormented by the devil and they are going to be delivered. There are many people here today that have not known Jesus and they're going to know Him this hour. What's happening over here? Come here. This girl was possessed by a devil. She was tormented by an evil spirit. Isn't it wonderful? Look around, saints of God.
Now, listen.
baby couldn't walk.
Yeah, yeah.
The baby couldn't walk.
And she's been in pain for 15 years, and she's never felt like eating until tonight. All the pain is gone. She's been set free.
This person could not walk. And now they are walking. Come up here and walk for Jesus. Come walk. Do you want the Spirit of the living God to come upon you and change you into another person? If you do, we are asking you, come right now, come up here and let Jesus touch you. We're asking you across the stadium right now. If you want to be born of God, then we simply invite you to come.
Hallelujah.
So this was the crusade we had in 2008, and even after that, in 2007 also we had in another place, and this is the biggest one so far. We haven't had such a biggest crusade in Nepal, and it has impacted many lives. And we thank God for this ministry. Even some of our students were in the volunteer group. So this time, briefly, I'd like to show about Nepal Theological College, where I have been principal for last many, many years. And now we have about 90 students doing training. And Pastor Mark was there recently, visited and ministered to our students. So it's a 4 minutes clips. I'd like to show that one. Then I'll share God's word. Thank you. Thank you very much. once again, it's my great privilege to be here in this congregation, in this church. And thank you for this opportunity given to me. This morning, I'd like to share with you briefly from the book of Acts. And I'll also share some of the experiences in our own country, Nepal. I'll read from Book of Acts, chapter 1, verse 8. Acts 1, 8. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. God has called us to be His witnesses. And witnesses can lead even unto the death. And if we look at the original meaning, martyrs, we die even physically for our, we die physically to that extent. When I look at my own country, Nepal, and I think you might have been told by Pastor Mark or any other person visiting, Nepal was a very close land for many, many, many centuries. And as we know, the Christian gospel went to different nations at different times. But as the Bible talks about, the gospel has to be preached. People need to know who Jesus Christ is. And when we talk of, when we look at Gospel of Matthew and other Gospels, the gospel has to be preached to the end of the world. People need to know who Jesus Christ is. And believing in Jesus Christ is not taking a new religion. Believing in Jesus Christ is receiving the inheritance that we lost because of sin.
Yes.
It's coming back to the family.
Yes.
It's not taking new religion, this and that, or rituals. It's a coming back to the family where we have lost our inheritance.
Yes.
That's the way we present gospel in our own country.
Yes.
So we are not making Christians, we are bringing people in God's kingdom,
yes,
God's family,
yes,
right? Where we have lost that inheritance, where we have lost our relationship with God, we bring back people into God's relationship as children of God.
Yes.
And I think that should be the focus of our mission. Focus of our mission, focus of our evangelism, focus of whatever we do in the kingdom of God is bringing people into God's house where they can have that close relationship with the Father through Jesus Christ. And I think Jesus is also instructing His disciples that once you receive the power of the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit convicts a person of their sins. Holy Spirit performs signs and miracles, wonders, by which people are delivered. People are set free, and they realize who God is. So the power of the Holy Spirit that Jesus promises is so essential for the ministry of the church. It is the Holy Spirit that brings people into His kingdom. Okay, now again, going back to the Nepali story, until 1950, Nepal had no Christian. Until 1950, about 64 years ago. No Christian at all. Anybody who went to Nepal with any Christian message was immediately arrested, put in prison, and if it was a person from from foreign land, it was deported immediately. But there were many attempts to go to inside our country. It was a very closed land. No education, no road access, nothing of that sort. Many people attempted to come to our country with the gospel, but they were arrested, put in prison. And I remember one story, what happened in 1921. One person attempted to come to Nepal. He was an Indian. He was from Punjab. So this young man, who studied in a Christian mission school, but he was against Christianity, because he felt the Christians from the overseas came and they destroyed all their culture and all kinds of things. So he was against Christianity. So at the age of 14, he tore New Testament Bible. This young man, he tore. He threw it. And from that day, he was unrest. He was restless in his spirit, in his heart. 14-year-old. Then he was so desperate in his life, he felt that I'm going to suicide. And the train was coming one of those days from that route, and he said, I'm going to die. A 14-year-old man. Why? And he prayed the last prayer. He comes from the Sikh community, Sikh religion, right? Like Hinduism. He comes from that community. And he prayed, if there is any God, reveal to me. And he never thought Jesus will reveal, because he thought he hated Jesus. He thought maybe some other Hindu gods or whatever may reveal to him if they want to save him. But at the middle of the night, because the morning 4 o'clock train, he was going to die under the train. And this man, Jesus met him middle of the night. 14-year-old man, old boy. And after Jesus spoke to him, he said, I have seen Jesus, and he wanted to tell to his family members. Everybody was so against him. They persecuted him, that he had to leave home. Then he became kind of wandering ascetic, Christian, preacher. In his meeting, big number of people used to come, 50, 60, 70, 80,000 in India. He traveled all over. He wanted to go to Tibet. You know, he had a very fascinating story called the Sadhu Sundar Singh, his name. The many books have been published on his in that name. So he wanted to go to Nepal. But when he went there, immediately he was arrested. He was put in prison for 4 or 5 days, and they deported him. So there was no Christian presence at all for a long, long time. But there were people border to Nepal and India praying for Nepal. They prayed for Nepal. God opened the door of the country that people may receive Jesus Christ. So this man, when he was deported from Nepal, he went to different parts of India, and he had a big convention in South India where maybe 100,000 people gathered that time, because it was more of, Kerala was a more of Christian concentrated place. And there he preached a message. He preached, that was in 1922 or 23. He preached, Nepal needs people to go and tell the good news. So if anybody is interested, because he told all his story, how he went to Nepal, how he was arrested, put in prison, and after a few days he was released, but we need to pray more for Nepal, and we need to send some people still in these difficult circumstances. So interesting, a mother who had a baby in her womb, dedicated that child for Nepal. I mean, interesting. The child wasn't born. Mother, when you see her, the mission field of Nepal, she said, when the child is born, I will raise up that child, I'll educate that child, and after that I'll send to Nepal. And that happened. That dedicated child actually came to Nepal in 1952. I mean, a very fascinating story. In 1950, there was some political change, and people slowly from outside started to come. But even then, government knew that people should not preach gospel. So they made a rule. Anybody becoming a Christian, 1 year imprisonment. Even that rule still stands. Still is there. But we don't obey that rule, that's all. That's all. Anybody becoming a Christian, 1 year imprisonment. Anybody distributing tracts, preaching, you could have arrested, Pastor Mark. Preaching, 3 years imprisonment. Anybody baptizing into water, 6 years imprisonment. That rule still stands. But we say God's rules are higher than human rules. Hallelujah. Yeah, that's what we say. Because God has eternal rules of bringing people to his home. Who can bring rule against that? No. We claim that. We say, no, we are not going to listen to that rule. If you read that rule, you may be a little bit disappointed. But you keep on moving. Because we have a greater God whose rules are eternal. Hallelujah. Yeah. Human rules are human rules, right? But we have God's rule, which are eternal. They don't change. So despite all those kinds of rules and regulation, people began to share the love of Jesus Christ. And I myself came to Christ in 1976. Prior to that, what happened? I was one of the candidates for school quiz contest. And I don't know whether you are familiar with that. There is a general knowledge kind of quiz contest. Like they have school competitions, right? So I was one of the members from my school, and we had to memorize 1,000 question answers. And we divided, five people divided 250 each. So in my section, there was a question. And at that time, I didn't know anything about Christianity, anything about Christ, nothing. Very young, at the age of maybe 14. There was a question, who is the light of the world? And the answer was Jesus Christ. In a general knowledge book. Not in Bible. God can use his word even written somewhere. Hallelujah. He can. So it says, who is the light of the world? The answer was Jesus Christ. And I had a curiosity, who is this Jesus Christ? Right? Light of the world means something very different. You know, very, very, kind of very young man, mind. So with this curiosity, I was looking for something about Jesus, because as I said before, you know, distributing tracts was also at risk during that time. The government was actually enforcing the law, that they don't do now much, but that time they enforced. That was way back in the 70s. So it might have been 74. Somebody came to my school and they sold literature, booklets, not distributing. You can see the now, you know, the why did they sold and didn't distribute? Because selling means it is the buyer who is responsible, right? Because you give little money and buy means it's not enforced on you. Distributing means the person can say, this fellow simply gave me, I took it. So it is a distributor who is responsible. In selling, who is responsible? The buyer. The man can say, I didn't force, he gave me money and he took it. So I'm not responsible for his buying. You see? So I had to buy Christian booklets, small ones, with little money, 25 paisa. Well, I read it while reading, Jesus died and rose again from the dead. It was a message that touched my heart. He died, rose again. Because I was influenced by Hindu beliefs at my home, and I was influenced by atheistic beliefs in my school. And I had a question of life right from the very young age. Why do we live in this world? What is the purpose of our existence? I had that kind of metaphysical questions right from the beginning. Why do we live? Because anywhere in the world you live, we have different kinds of problems and challenges. There is no place in the world where there are no problems. And sometimes I say, if you say, I'm going to a place where there are no problems, before you reach there, problem always reaches and says, welcome, I'm already here. So there is no place in the world, whether you go east or west, south or north, doesn't matter, right? Anywhere, there are challenges, there are problems in the world, maybe different kinds. Problems are of different nature, right? So I was very much kind of, you know, questioning myself, what is the life all about to live in this world? With atheism, there's nothing after this life. Nothing remains. The whole thing is you live in this world and you die, finished. But I was not very satisfied with that kind of atheistic answers. And I had a question, what is this life? And when I read Jesus died and rose again, that was something different than what I was hearing from others. So that captivated my heart, my mind, and I began to do correspondence course. There's an address down. I did correspondence course for at least 2 full years before becoming Christian. Bible correspondence course. Studying Bible, but I wasn't a Christian. I was interested. I was interested to know who Jesus, and there are a lot of miracles and signs, you know, that the booklets that they send, and I was actually trained myself in Bible without becoming a Christian. And I wanted to meet some Christians, but I could not, because in 1976, there were not more than 1,000 Christians from east to west, north to south in Nepal. Not more than 1,000, just 1,000. So getting to know Christians was difficult, to find Christians was difficult. When I became Christian in 1976, I was the first Christian in my whole district. First one. And last year, there was a Christmas rally we had in our district headquarters, Christmas rally. There were about maybe 6,000-7,000 people. And we marched the different cities, some in motorbike and some walking with the flags. Jesus has risen from the dead. We do all these kinds of things there. Yeah, we are preaching, we are distributing tracts and big, you know, and many people, you know, watching it and getting the tracks and other kinds of thing. And finally we met in a big park, big ground. And we had a program, preaching program and singing and all. Easter Sunday, after marching many places. And they declared that I was the first Christian in that district. Became Christian in 1976. So you can imagine, the Christian presence wasn't there at all. So when I became Christian in 1976, Then I had a lot of persecutions and challenges from my home, from my family's others. Then I had Bible training and other kinds of things, so I'll not tell all those stories. But God has been gracious. And I have been convinced to bring a blessing to our nation, God has to do through His church. Church. Yes. Church is the answer.
Yes. Yes.
Not only in our nation, even in this nation.
Yes.
Please understand that.
Yes.
Because this nation has been begun with the grace of God. If you look at the history of this nation. And it was the church that brought this stability in communities, a sacrificial love, a help. And I think for our own country, we are, from Bible, we are experiencing the preaching of the Word of God, beginning of the churches in different centers is going to change our communities, change our nation. We are praying for that. And I was sharing with Pastor Mark, because we want to make church as a center of a community. Through that, we tell the good news of Jesus Christ. We minister to the needs of the community, but through the witnesses of Jesus Christ. So now we have many churches, as we have read in the book of Acts. And many times the book of Acts is so relevant to our Nepalese context. You see all the persecution there, arrest there, putting prison there, all those things are part of our experiences. So book of Acts is very close to us, very dear. But through the power of the Holy Spirit, the disciples went everywhere. They were bold by His strength. And they spoke the word of God, and people even challenged them. They didn't listen. They listened what God told them to listen. And book of Acts has been a very inspiring book for me and for all of us in our country. And as I said, 1976, there were 1,000 believers. But now exactly we don't have the census. It is estimated 1.5 million Christians. So in my own lifetime, I'm not that old man. So I could see from 1,000 to 1.5 million, that's something.
Yeah.
I mean?
Yeah.
But we are not satisfied with that. We want to have more.
Yes.
We have 30 million people, so 1.5 is very little, right? So we have to see 28.5 million people. Hallelujah. That should be our target. Not just 1.5 and we're satisfied. No. We need to move on with the gospel of Jesus Christ, with signs and, you know, manifestations of the kingdom of God. And we have seen in the video what happened in our crusades, and it repeats every church service. It repeats. And I have seen literally from my own eyes, experience, how transformation has taken place in different villages. I was recently in one of the villages in Nepal, and Pastor Mark had been in Dhangadi, but there's a beyond that is a Kanchanpuri area. When first we went in 82, there was just one church with 5-6 people. And lot of persecution, lot of, different kinds of rituals they were doing. But as we went there and preached the gospel with lot of persecution challenges, we could see the community societies were being transformed. And even in that areas now, there are more than maybe now 50 churches. They have even church buildings now. Their children are educated in colleges and universities, we can see how gospel can bring not only a spiritual transformation, it can bring a social transformation.
Yes.
Because the gospel is holistic. And it begins with people's relationship with God. And when the relationship with God is been established, relationship with others also comes in line. The greatest problem of this world is not economics, though sometimes we may think. It's not a politics. It is not a sociological problem or family problem. The greatest problem of this world is the spiritual problem that they have lost relationship with God. And you look at Bible, when Adam first sinned, Adam and Eve, the first thing was not broken relationship between man, husband and wife, but broken relationship between God and human. That's the first one. Then after that, there is a broken relationship within family. So until people restore the relationship with God and human, other relations are not going to be restored. It will be some patching things may happen, but it will not be resolving. So we need to see that God has to bring this reconciliation to humanity. Any society, humans are humans. Humans are humans in all societies. Some are educated sinners, some are wealthy sinners, some are poor sinners, all are sinners. Yeah?
Yeah.
Yes?
Yes.
Yeah. Everywhere, yes. Humans are humans, and these humans need relationship with God.
Amen.
And we need to pray for that. We need to pray, God, bring that relationship with people. Your relationship with people will be restored. And when that takes place, many other kinds of problems will be resolved. But if we are not able to bring that relationship with God, then other things will not resolve. And that is the message that Jesus wanted to give through the church, through disciples. And Jesus said, when the Spirit of God comes, God comes upon you, you will be empowered. You will get the strength. You will get that faith. You will get that ability from me. And you will be my witnesses. Beginning from Jerusalem, and in Judea, and in Samaria, and to the uttermost part of the world. You will be my witnesses all over the world at the same time. There's written word both. You will be my witnesses both in Jerusalem, both in Judea and Samaria and outermost part of the world. So the mission is not like we are completing our work in one nation, then we begin to another one. No. Because work never finishes until Jesus comes. Hallelujah. Yeah, it is continuous. So we do our mission here, we do mission in other nations. Both. The gospel will be preached in Jerusalem and outermost part of the world at the same time.
Yeah.
You can't finish Jerusalem and I'll go to Samaria, Judea. No. There's no day to finish like that. So we need to do together the work of God. In all over the world, different nations with different people, and those people will continue God's work. So it's a great privilege for me to speak to you, and I believe that God has entrusted us something that is so important, and we have to think about it. Oh God, how precious thing that you have given to us, to me, how I can take these things to others who do not have. When we have that prayer, it is God who provides us the way to share this love with others. Because today the world is actually longing for love, longing for love, God's love. They're trying different ways, hard ways, you know, simple ways, all kinds of ways to get some kind of peace, happiness. People go to drugs, people go to other kinds of things, you know, just to satisfy. But that's not going to bring satisfaction. They end up with all kinds of trouble. But God has given us His own nature, His own life, that He is asking humans accept it. Mm-hmm. It's so simple. Sometimes people feel Christianity is so simple, they want always complicated things, see? It's so simple, actually. And people want to be complicated and be complicated. But God wants to be too simple, accepting what God has offered for us through Jesus Christ. And this is our commitment, that we'll continue to serve God. And I have been involved in theological education and church ministry, even church planting. And we want to increase this one, and we want to use our students for evangelism, planting of churches. So please pray with us. We want to do the things that God wants us to do. And though there may be oppositions from the political parties or other people, but we are not actually fearful with them. I mean, we keep our courtesy, we become gentle in talking, right? We don't become harsh, but we gently talk. But we talk what Christianity can offer to our people. We are changing people's lives, see? Actually, we are helping government, right? We are helping people not to be criminals. Yeah? So we are helping the government. What wrong we are doing? Nothing. Yeah? So I sometimes have this kind of talk with some of the, you know, big leaders. Tell me one thing, what wrong we have done. Can you tell me? No? Then why should you worry about our preaching? Because we want to bring transformation internally. Yeah. Recently we had, just before I came on second, on first we had a, no, I came on first. I think it was 30th. We had a Global Day of Prayer opening. It's like 40 days of prayer. And that day, I was asked to preach for the leaders who gathered in one church. And that day, one SSP came. It's a superintendent of police of Kathmandu, you know, our capital, whole Kathmandu Valley, right? He's the head of that. So he came, and I was speaking from Bible. I was saying, we need to have internal change. Simply enforcing of law is not going to change people. They will be more hard. We need internal change, and that change can come through our prayers and through God's word. We have to help people to be internally changed. So I was preaching that and he was listening. And later on he made a comment. He said, we need the help of Christian in this nation to change people internally. Hallelujah. That is the saying of SSP. He's the kind of superintendent of police of that area. So there is a high expectation even from different people that we do bring a change in our society. And it's the gospel that can transform. Nothing. No big education, no big wealth, those all things are needed. But it is the transforming power of the Holy Spirit that can change a person's life, his perspective, thinking, why we live in this world. And God has given me a mandate. I live in this world with two purposes. One is to know God. The second one is to make Him known. Yes. That's all. I want to know him more and more, and also I want to make him known to the people who do not know him. That's the whole purpose of human existence. Nothing else. Nothing else. We do all kinds of work. Good. But what is our driving purpose is to know our Savior, Jesus Christ, and to make him known to our friends, to our family members, to our neighbors, whomever. We can just say, okay, God loves you. The person will hear that word and say, what does it mean, God loves me? Later on, the person will think again, right? Because the word of God, I said, Jesus is light of the world. Just that changed my life in the sense, curiosity. So you can tell to your friend, Jesus loves you. What you are telling? What is that? You don't need to explain maybe too much now. The person, it will ring back in the mind. Because humans are humans, right? They are fragile being, weak being. When they hear God helping them, they'll respond. And we have a great privilege to serve Jesus Christ despite all the challenges. And God is good, and he will help us to continue this mission. Please pray for us, for our ministry, for our Bible college. We want to train more people in different ways, through extension program, through more increase of our student body. And we want to do what God wants to do. We appreciate your prayers for us, your partnership in the ministry of the Lord. And thank you, Pastor Mark, for giving me this opportunity. And may the Lord bless each one of us. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen.
Everybody, won't you just stand with us?
Hallelujah.
Stand with us. Hallelujah. We just thank the Lord Jesus for such amazing partnerships that he's given us in the world, especially in Nepal. And the partnership that we have with you. We have a partnership with you. You're standing here in this place today because you want to know Jesus. You're standing in this place today because you want to be used by him. Is there anybody here? Perhaps maybe you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ. You've not had the miracle of salvation. Boy, it is a miracle. It's an amazing miracle. It surpasses any miracle that you could ever even imagine. It's a miracle that God has for you right now.
Hallelujah.
It's a miracle. Amen. Where you go leave a life that is an ordinary human existence to step over into a relationship with the living God, and that is heaven. To know Jesus is to
Amen.
Live in heaven. But for those of you that are standing here today and you've called upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we have to recognize that he's made us the light of the world. And as a minister of the gospel, as a person who stands here at this most critical time period, one of the most perilous time periods that has ever existed, and I would say probably the most perilous time period that has ever existed, and is going to get worse according to what the Word of God reveals to us. We have to see God raise up in our generation some of the most radically Holy Ghost-filled people, which means simply people that are absolutely surrendered to the life of God. And we preach in a radical way, calling people out of a world that they have compromised with, because people don't understand why they can't enjoy some form of sin and still walk with God. And they've not yet really been touched by the reality of something so very, very important. That heaven and everything that God has and everything that he is separated and contrary and cut off in every way from all the things that has now found even a place of acceptance in the ranks of the church. It's called sin. It's called worldliness. It's a very difficult message right now. There is a great challenge going on, because what happens is this. We want God to change his mind about things. And go ahead and accept us with all of these compromises, and then in that little bit of turmoil, that little bit of a problem, that little bit of leaven that exists in the church, now we want to take another step and we want to dilute the gospel and say, okay, you can come on into the church, you can come on into the company of saints, you don't really have to change yet. And with that, ultimately the little bit of leaven leavens the whole lump. And with that, no change ever really takes place. And so he's stuck in religious expressions. So he's standing here today, standing up here on this platform with Baal, my friend, who represents the unreached nation of this earth. That I'm telling you, I was telling my dear brother this morning, there's absolutely no possible way that the 1.5 million are going to turn into 30 million unless we keep the fire of the Holy Ghost constantly burning in the midst of those who have been touched by the presence of God, because too easily the compromise imposes itself upon you. The defeat imposes itself on you. I just said, look, Baal, go back and just turn the fire up. Just turn the fire preaching. Listen, I come from a long line of revivalists. Understand this. I've been in revival all my life. I'm 54 years old. Listen to me now. I know how the Great Awakenings took place in the United States of America. I know how the revivals took place in the United States of America. I know how the sweeping moves of the Spirit of the Lord swept this nation. It was because there were consecrated, radical men of God who did not let up on the Word, that called people to a place of repentance and holiness, a place to be baptized in the glory and the fire of God, and did not let up. They would have meetings that would last 12, 18, weeks, sometimes 6 months, protracted meetings. Father has put it upon my heart, I'm getting ready to start engaging in this. I'm getting ready to go ahead and do what we've seen the revivalists of old. God, what God showed Grandpa still works today. What God showed Great Grandpa still works today. What God showed our Father still works today. Still works today. And I'm basically where I've come is, it just doesn't matter. To start with, how many people show up? But I'm telling you right now, we're going to believe God that everybody that does show up in short order, the fire of God is going to so burn in their heart, because when you receive power from on high, when the fire of God comes upon you, it literally takes it. When Jesus talked about the fire of God, the baptism of the Holy Ghost, he was talking about everything that he knows himself in that which exists in the framework of the living God, which he was always a part of from forever and forever. He said that is going to come upon you, and when that glory, when that spirit of holiness, when that passion, when that power, when that divine gifting comes upon you, it is only in that context that you can give a testimony of me. It's only in that context that you can represent me. It's only in that context that you will have the ability to call people out of darkness into light. It's only there that transformation takes place. Amen. Oh, but the compromise and the settling out for something less. But see, for me, there's fire on the inside of me. Amen. It is lit by God. And it's going to continue to burn. And it's going to burn brighter. And it's going to get reproduced all over the nations of the earth. Because God the Holy Ghost is seeing to it. God the Holy Ghost. I don't have to see to it. I'm going to participate with it. But God the Holy Ghost will see to it. To where that we say, Father, we only want it your way. We only want your will. We only want to do it like you defined it to be done. Not like the people pressure that are put on us. I've been there. I've watched many times where all of a sudden the people are scattering and the enemy is coming up on you and you feel the intensity of it, and the intensity is trying to pressure you to just compromise a little bit, and then the people won't scatter and we'll have an ability to stop the enemy that's threatening our existence. Saul buckled. And he lost his place in God. Because the voices are great to compromise. The voices are great to say, no, 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 no. Just make some small adjustments to God's divine order. It's okay. And boy, deception works to justify anything. Dear people, we're going to go at this thing. My dear friend Tim Hall, evangelist Tim Hall's coming in on Sunday. I said, let's do it, man. Let's kick this thing off. Let's see what God will do. We're going to be here Sunday night, Monday night, Tuesday night, Wednesday night, starting next Sunday. And we're going to believe God for just such a Holy Ghost fire to fall upon people. And you know, and I know what's happening. And I talk about this with people all the time on the inner circles of ministry. You know, I hear this all the time. Yeah, you know, I know those churches aren't right. I know those people aren't even in the flow of the Holy Ghost. I know they think they are, but they're not. But we're just going to go over there. We're going to minister to them anyways. And we're going to let the grace of God see signs, wonders, and miracles. Perhaps they'll change. But reality of it is, we continue to see a continual decline in the fear of God where there is no fear of God. We continue to see a decline in the realm of faith where there is more doubt and unbelief. And understand, in those contexts, God was told Abraham, said, Abraham, be careful in this place. There is no fear of me. Jesus says, I could do not many mighty works there because of their unbelief. The only thing that's going to break through that is this place, this altar, where people don't come. Maybe they do to start with. They don't ultimately end up just staying because they've got their own ideas, they got their own agendas, they got their own belief system, they got their own concept of what God ought to be doing. Let me tell you something. You don't know what God ought to be doing. I'm going to tell you something. I don't know what God ought to be doing. Huh? I'm going to follow Him. I'm supposed to be led by Him. I can understand in a general sense what God wants to do, and I can understand it in the most general sense that it's holiness of holinesses. I know that. I know that that is an unfailing word. I know that it's absolutely what God wants to do is take us out of this world, which is His enemy, and bring us into His household, bring us into His home. People want to come with the world. And somehow the message has been compromised and said, okay, it's okay, you can come with the world. No. God demands a radical change. And He's provided a radical change. And only you and I can show the difference of why that change should be valued and wanted, because they see within our life the fire of God's divine life burning. They see every good and perfect gift. They see joy unspeakable and full of glory. They see peace that passes. They see life and abundant life. They see every wonderful thing. These yokes that have stood in your way, you're going to have to recognize God's given you the power to deal with them. It's not just another prayer line. These hindrances that would try to prevent you, because Satan is so against the anointing, so opposes the manifest presence of God. These things, in Jesus' mighty name, you have to stand up against them. It's your turn. Hello. It's your turn, man. It's your turn. I'm 54 now. I said, Papa, all I want to do is just start training folks. Let me just go and just train people. Let me go do mass evangelist crusade and just train people. You're not stopping to train yet. You're not that old. It's time to kick it in. I mean, come on, people. I want you to think about it. I want you to think about how many people have let God raise them up and season them in faith and purity and holiness and virtues and the things that God highly values. Men value different things. They value all the realms in the intellect and all the realms in material wealth. God values a whole different set of things. How many people have let God develop them into a realm of faith to take nations? A realm of faith, really just to stand against the opposition that would try to steal from you this joy, this peace, this glory, this divine ability to shine with the light of the world. Your light has come. Jesus is the light of the world. Amen. Arise now, ha, and shine. And Jesus said, you are the light of the world. A city set up on a hill that cannot be hid. Thank you for the authority that you've given to us in Jesus Christ, your only begotten Son. Father, I thank you for the anointing of the Holy Ghost that breaks off every yoke, that ruins every trick of Satan, that exposes every lie of the enemy. Father, I thank you that today in this place is presented a company of people that says, oh God, for you alone I live, and in your life abundant, I define all that I desire. In Jesus' name, I destroy the power of religion. I destroy it and I break off its yoke from off your neck. His yoke from off your shoulders. Dear people, sin is the power that Satan uses to destroy humanity. The smallest act of sin or disobedience separated Adam from the living God. It's a testimony that sounds out to all humankind. It's a testimony that is the strong defense of exactly what it is God has chose and what he demands. It cannot be denied. When Jesus Christ came, he was manifested in the flesh to destroy the power of sin. No power or testimony can stand so strong as that one that Jesus Christ gave of Father's will. You got to understand, sin is a poison that produces death and spiritual separation. You got to understand, sin is a power that hardens people's hearts. And it's time that God's people get right so that the light can shine. And somebody says, let up on it. No, don't let up on it. I'll stand here and shout out all the louder. Hallelujah. All the more I cry out, all the more. Until the time comes in which you stand up and you begin to cry out all the more. And say, hey, look, we found another, a better place worth living. We found a realm that we want to invite you into. If you'll step over into it, you'll understand why God feels the way he feels about things. I'm praying over every one of you standing here right now. I just want you to yield yourself to the Lord. However it is you yield, I believe that the lifting of the hands is the lifting of the heart. That's what the Lord says. I lift up my hands as an evening sacrifice, which is a place of just total offering yourself up to the Lord. And I tell you now in the name of Jesus Christ and by the authority of Jesus Christ, be filled with the Spirit. Be filled with the glory. Be filled with the manifest presence of his divine power and grace. Be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. Be washed in the blood of Jesus. Every yoke broken in Jesus' name. Every hindrance removed. Every hindrance removed right now. Say with me, say, for me to live is Christ Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for such an abundant life. Thank you, Lord, for such a wonderful life. If you don't know this life, if somehow you're separated from the manifest presence of God, you've only known religion. If you don't know the power of this life, and therefore you're constantly overcome by sin and by the powers of darkness that lie in wait to destroy you and deceive you, we want to pray for you because we got the goods right here. We got the genuine article of divine power and authority that is in Christ Jesus, the only begotten Son of God. He's come with His anointing, hallelujah, with the power of the Holy Ghost to fill you up with everything that you need to be able to stand against all the wiles, all the tricks, all the devices of the enemy. He's come with power and authority to tread upon scorpions and serpents and over all the power of the enemy. So from this day forward, nothing shall be able to touch you, hurt you, harm you. If that's interesting to you, if that's something that you desire to have, if God the Holy Ghost is tugging on your heart and you in a desperate need for it, then we invite you to come. We'll pray with you and for you. I guarantee you, things will change. Things will radically change. Hallelujah. Things will change. If you have any sickness or disease in your body, once again, we'll pray with you. The power of God is here to heal you. We'll hook up with faith with you. Everything will change, dear people. Dear people. This is the most, you may not understand, this is the most exciting and most eventful thing you've done all week. There's nothing more exciting than what can take place right here, not out there, but right here in the midst of His house, right here in the midst of His church. And we want your eyes to be open. We want you to be able to see it and know it and believe it. It's time for a great move of the Spirit. It's time for Holy Ghost revival. It's time for great conviction to fill the planet. Starting with the church, it's time for great conviction. Holy Ghost, conviction to fill the hearts of people everywhere. And it starts with your life. Just say to the Holy Spirit, say, Holy Spirit, let your Holy Ghost conviction so overwhelm me, so fill me. Just ask Him, let his presence so overwhelm you, so fill you. He'll respond to that. Just lift your hands one more time. Just be refreshed. For those of you who are laboring and are weary, be strengthened now. Be filled right now. Be filled right now. Be filled right now. Now we want to invite you to come and worship the Lord with your tithes and with your offerings. There's a miracle in it. The smallest acts of obedience will create the greatest miracles of faith for you. Don't make it a ritual. Don't make it something that you got to do. It's not by constraint, but actually make it a participation of worshiping God and an act of obedience wherein, Father, work a miracle of multiplication for you. So I want you to come. Anybody wants prayer, I want you to come. I want you to come right now. If you want prayer for anything, we want you to come. Ball and I will pray for you. We want you to come. I want you to come back to the meeting tonight. We'll be here at 6 o'clock tonight. Prayer starts at 5 o'clock. I pray that you'll come to know and understand what prayer is. What touching heaven is. Anybody with any needs at all. Anybody with any needs at all. You may come. Otherwise, find a bunch of people around you, hug them, tell them that you love them, bless them in the name of Jesus. But we want you to be mindful that the church service is still going on. And if you want prayer for anything, we're here to pray with you and for you. I'll even open it up a little bit more. If you want just a greater vision for the lost, if you want God to use you in a greater way in this nation and at the same time in other nations, well, just come. See the power of God stir you. We'll see you get stirred up. Hallelujah. Just start down there anywhere. Ball, just anywhere. Just start. Yeah, you go right on ahead. Hallelujah. Suko Ramana. Suka Dana Mangalisataya. If you've not been baptized in the Holy Ghost, I mean, if there's anything in God you haven't got, you want it, just come up here. I'm telling you. Hallelujah. Rambon does. That's right. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Power of God's on you. God's on you right now. He's touching you. Change comes into your life right now. That's the anointing of the Holy Ghost. That's the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Everything begins to change right now in your life. Everything, mambrung jala mala say atoya. Irasoramai. Yeah, just lift your hands towards heaven. Hallelujah. 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 Praise God. Sandra, come up here. Come up here. See this dear lady get baptized in the Holy Ghost. Receive right now. Power of God comes on you. Power of God comes on you right now. Power of God comes on you right now. Fire God. Fuego de Dios. Fuego de Dios. Fuego de Dios. Fuego de Dios.
In Jesus' name.
Fuego de Dios.
Right there. The Spirit of God.
Fire God on you right now. Hallelujah. Father, thank you for the anointing.
Be filled with the Spirit of God right now.
Everywhere you go, devil's going out. Everywhere you go, power of God. Everywhere you go, power of God being made.